Welcome back to Let's Play Disco Elysium Blind. I am Amethyst Luntari, as always, here at the bookstore. We need to help Suna with her project. Find the giant ice bear fridge in the Doom commercial area, which is in here. We need to find a filament memory with an off-site copy. And apparently it's in here. Get the music back on. There's some pretty nice music in here. Alright, we need to get back here, so we need to talk to her first. It's only proper.
Hello again, esteemed officer, and welcome to Crime, Romance, and Biographies of Famous People.
You don't really need to shorten the name of this bookstore. I was told there's a huge fridge in the building's cellar. Can you lead me there? A fridge? She fidgets with her pendant. No, I don't know anything about a fridge. Aren't you interested in books? She nods at the bookshelves. Drama says, for whatever reason, she's lying to you about the fridge. Seems like you have to find your own way to the cellar. Alright, I wanted permission to go back there, but I guess we're just gonna go back there. The curtains, tattered with age and covered in dust, hang before you, as if taunting you. Just as you're about to pull apart the curtains, the petrified voice of the shop owner cries out once more. Sir, don't touch that. I told you it's off-limits for the customers. Her hand has closed around her pendant, her fingers nervously playing with the talisman. What's with this pendant? Parapsychologically speaking, we're done. If you decide to open them, I won't be held responsible for the consequences. It's too dangerous. Perception says she looks away, mumbling. Why is everyone always messing with the curtains? Why can't they just buy books like normal people? I heard that there's a fridge there that I need. Everybody suddenly needs something from there. She waves her hands angrily. Leave the curtains be. It's what it wants. Everybody. I guess maybe just Suna and Harry. This is about the curse? That's why you're afraid? No, it's just a storeroom for the employees, I told you. Now please step away from the curtains. She's almost begging you. Ma'am, this is different. I'm a police officer. I need to get in there. Why? It's not like anyone was killed there. She stops abruptly as her hand flies over her mouth, baffled by her own bluntness. Was someone killed there? I am sorry, I don't mean to be so impolite. You just please don't go there. I can't allow that. You'll only make things worse and unleash the powers. Oh boy. Savoir-faire says, the curtains do seem frail suddenly, not robust enough to contain a slippery darkness. But I sense this place calling for me. I must investigate beyond the threshold. You do? She grabs her pendant again, visibly shaken. My God, even more reasons to not mess with the curtains. Just step away, dear sir. I'll think about it for a little while. Thank you. The shopkeeper lets out a loud sigh. Let's just talk about this first, all right? There's no reason for you to venture into the unknown. Rhetoric says, talking is always good. Go see what she has to say. Inland Empire says, there is something mysterious about the curtains. Be careful. Okay, you know what? If we're done, I'm gonna buy the other books I want. The thing is, I don't know about the board games. We have plenty of money. I want to buy the Him Dollar Man book. Oh yes, certainly. She rubs her hands together. Another good sale. Not reading them yet. I'm gonna look at them though. A classic. On the frontispiece, an anatomically unrealistic muscle man is reaching into a mountain stream, yearning to touch his glimmering mirror image. His eyes are full of childlike wonder. On the blood-soaked snow, right next to him lie two giant Zweihanders. 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 I don't know how to say it. Alright, so I'm not reading them yet. I might not even read them in this playthrough, but I can always load a save and go from there. If I don't get a chance to read them, I have a feeling we're getting, like, to the part where we're starting to run out of time, only a couple days before all chaos breaks loose. Like Joyce was saying, they would kill all... They would kill 1,000 people, would be dead. I want to buy this Dick Mullen novel. Hmm, of course. She shudders. Such violence and immorality. I mean, enjoy. Alright. Stuff to read at some point. Another Dick Mullen book. Oh, it's like a thick one. Look woefully misrepresenting the police work. In this one, our detective returns from a trip having successfully solved a 100-year-old case, only to embark on another. Does he finally face the taxing nature of his occupation? No, he doesn't even look like a normal law officer. And then down here, I'm not going to buy that expensive one. I mean, I could. $25. I want to buy the suzerainty game. Wonderful choice, sir. She smiles at you. A wholesome family game. I can't buy the other. A civilization-building board game where you get to choose a nation and set off to colonize and exploit other cultures. A star-shaped note on the box proclaims the game now includes a completely new genocide option. Wonderful. Like a bloodier, more violent risk, I guess? Now, supposedly we can talk to her about this? Hope we get more money from Encyclopedia.
Hello again, esteemed officer. And welcome to Crime, Romance, and Biographies of Famous People.
You don't have to welcome me again. I'm still here. Why are you so uptight about those curtains? I just want to know what's on the other side. I already told you. It's just a storage room for employees. I don't understand why it's so important to you. Okay, why is it so important to you? Just let it go, officer. Go buy some goddamn books. You're supposed to be drawn to the books. I have bought them. She recites it like it's a poem, or like she's given, like she's playing a role she's grown tired of, drama says. Why are you still talking about the books? Are you trying to put a spell on me? A spell? As if. I didn't mean to snort that loud. This place doesn't need any spells or hoodoo mumbo jumbo. This place has wonderful energy. She wavers under your gaze, mouth pressed into a tight-lipped smile. Then something breaks. Okay, fine. It's because this place is cursed, just like everyone said. They don't call it the doomed commercial area for nothing. Are you happy now, officer? Happy that you've ruined everything? She closes her eyes and starts mumbling something to the pendant. How does this curse manifest itself? A shiver runs through the woman as she looks around this in the dimly lit store. The curse is so much worse than you could imagine. It's a disease, eating at the very foundation. Her voice drops to a whisper. It's the curse of financial distress, of ruin, and bankruptcy. She peers at the curtains again. Inland Empire says, Didn't that curtain just move? Okay, I'm a little confused. What does that mean? Everyone knows that all the previous companies in this building have sooner or later declared bankruptcy, and their malicious spirits are still here, feeding off bad business practices and disappointing income statements. There's something wrong with this building, I can tell you. Ever since I arrived, I've sensed an eerie, lingering presence, as if I was unwanted here. Empathy says, sounds familiar. Strange. I feel unwanted, too. What does it mean? Truly so. Her eyes narrow as she tries to get a read on your energy. Perhaps the dark energies are leeching off you? You shouldn't stay in the store too long. It may be dangerous. Why didn't you just tell me right away it's the curse? It's not good to talk about the curse. Not in detail. The negativism. She shivers. It's dangerous. Talking about the void wraiths angers them. Conceptualization says, wow. Void wraiths. You have new words. Physical instruments say, such wraiths may prove a formidable enemy. Suit up. I don't think they're real, at least I hope not. Have you sought help from anyone? Yes, I've contacted numerous parapsychologists and even a pair of Seminese mediators. They provided me with the wards. She nods at the strange cage-like trinket on the curtains. The wards help to keep the doom at bay and protect us against the darkness that lies further in the building, even though now I fear it's not enough. Is your pendant part of the wards as well? Oh, this? She holds the pendant in her palm. Its ochre heart glistens under the lights. No, it's a special Himayan amulet blessed by desert pygmy shamans with a spell of compulsion. It's to compel people to buy books. Why does she keep holding it then? Well, she's holding it to try to compel me to buy books, not to ward off the spirit. There are numerous spells cast throughout the store. I had the books anointed with a different inducement spell. For example, it's guaranteed to boost sales 15%. Rhetoric says, desert pygmy shamans? That sounds like a rather questionable way to describe a group of people. Yeah. Would you like me to take the case? I could investigate, see if the curse is real. Most certainly not. I don't want anyone who's not familiar with the psychic arts to get involved in this mess. Stay away. Leave the spirits be so they can return to their slumber. My liege, Drama says. You know what this case calls for? A paradetective. Very high. I had a few more questions about the curse, do I? No, never mind, I have the questions. Okay, but please, only a few questions. He peers at the curtains. You wouldn't want to disturb the spirits. The woman looks aloof, her features much softer. Occasionally she glances at her daughter's silhouette. You have to let me to the cellar. There's something I desperately need from there. Who? What? I don't understand what you're talking about. I can't in good conscience risk releasing the bane of doom upon all because you need something from the cellar. It's not just something from the cellar. I'm doing it for your previous neighbor, Suna Lucanan Killed. Oh, you mean that girl with those bizarre machines? Humph, I recall her now. Her energetic presence was off, very off. She kept rambling about something about her memory being lost. She means computer memory. In fact, she pauses to think, it's odd how many of these troubles started with her departure. How do I know she's not behind the curse? We definitely have to contain it now. Alright, so yeah, convince her to let you investigate the doomed commercial area. Very high, +2 for helped Annette. Oh, that's the little girl there. Helped Annette in, or let her get in the store itself because she was standing out in the rain. +1 on a quest to find the offsite copy. Let's try it. Yay. We rolled very low. I'm glad we worked on it because two ones is always failing. That's like your critical miss kind of thing. Slither up to her, you silver-tongued fiend, Drama says. Show her what world-class perfidy looks like. Wait, what if I don't want to lie? You're not lying. You're giving her peace of mind. The means are thus justified. I might as well be speaking parcel tongue. Ma'am, I came to help. I've handled paranatural situations before. Are you sure? She looks skeptical. Don't think I haven't seen charlatans before. I return from the void. I sense the psychic emanations from afar. The sleeper beyond calls out. She shudders. I'm not sure I can trust your claims. Honestly, you look like a bit of a drinker. I'm sorry for being so blunt, but... You cannot refuse me. I've succeeded in my check. The lieutenant keeps his usual stony calm. He silently picks out his notebook. Esprit de Corps says, Go ahead then. Rock her world, he thinks. I'll compose some notes. I admit I've had my share of drinks, but only because the spectral realm is parapsychologically taxing. How do you know all this? Drama says, Here we go. Your wards brought me here in the first place. I am the Void Revenant. I have the power to deband all the bad. She'd probably buy it, but that sounds ridiculous. Your wards brought me here in the first place. The Seminese blood also runs through me. You're part Seminese? Oh, it means our meeting couldn't have been mere chance. The hand of fate guides us. We're in. But I am not the only one at risk. I have to think of my daughter. You are certain you can help us, keep us safe? I can't allow any collateral damage to hit us. I'll spare Kim. No problem whatsoever. Your family is safe. The phantoms are no match for me. She shuffles nervously. If you promise, good officer, then... She pauses. You might be our last hope. Do you swear it? On my honor. Thank you, sir. A timid sigh of relief, followed by a cautious smile. There's one more thing I haven't told you about yet. The entity. Jama says, do not act surprised. You know of these things. Of course, the entity, for I have sensed its presence. You have? The entity takes the form of a woman, a witch, probably. I suspected that she must be connected to the curse ever since I first saw her. Do you know that she lives inside the chimney? Chimney, the passage between heaven and hell, of course. Yes, that chimney is part of the building's central furnace, and it's enormous. She has barricaded herself behind some metal security curtains. God knows what she's doing there. I got a key. Some unnatural magic, I assume, she shivers. You should go find the entity and ask what happened to all the companies in the building. What is the source of this curse? Here's the key to the warded door behind the curtains. Take it. Oh, and please, do return to me after you've looked around. I'm quite anxious to know what she has to say about the curse. What you discover in there. Inland Empire says, unbelievable darkness and ruin. I don't know, I'm gonna crush. That's it. Authority says, honorable one, you have accumulated a substantial amount of honor points on your life path. You're a man most virtuous. Wait, there were honor points? Of course there were honor points. Did you think no one was paying attention to all of your honorable deeds, honorable one? I only try my best. It's the most any of us can do. Oh, the modesty on this one. Another 10 honor points for you, sir. Huh. You are on the fast track to becoming one of the rarest, most revered of all police officers, an honor cop. Isn't honor sort of an archaic concept? Living in the name of virtue and doing noble deeds while expecting nothing in return is not archaic. How can you even think that? Selflessness forms the basis for the warrior code, an ageless code, as fit for nomadic Ilmarian tribes traversing the vast red plateau in Provincia Gerti as it is for your neighborhood postman. That's one hell of a sentence. A warrior code, you say? I do feel like a warrior. This whole thing is beginning to sound very me. Mm-hmm. You're like a wandering night monk, setting right the wrongs of the world you come upon. Are you ready to drink deep from the cup of honor? My honor is my life. Yes, your deeds have spoken for you, honorable one. But to fully drape oneself in an eternal cloak of honor, a ritual must be completed, a rite of honor. Even among the honorable, only the most dignified are deemed worthy, but you, O honorable one, have excelled in honor. Honor comes from deep within you, and to truly know oneself, to know one's honor, one must reach deep within oneself and touch one's honor. Okay, I guess this is a thought we're gonna have percolating. Okay. You need to bring the thumb of your right hand, your sword hand, to your rectum. My rectum? And stick it in there to form the arch of honors. Stick my finger in my... What? What if someone comes and sees me? Then they will witness honor so great, it seems nigh impossible a single man can contain it. They will admire you, honorable one. You're crazy if you think I'm going to stick a finger in my butt. No way. Most dishonorable are those who have known honor, carried honor in their hearts, and then disowned honor. They are the honor fallen. Can I do it later when I'm not standing in front of this woman? You brought much shame on your family today. Your name will forever be tarnished by this most shameful of deeds. Be forever banished, shameful one. What? Oh, I thought I would have lost morale or something, but no. Search for the malignant entity. Plaisance said she lives inside a chimney. Find a way in. Look at this honor stuff. That's crazy. Okay. I thought it was going to be a thought. We have 39 minutes left for that. Alright, here goes nothing. I'm thinking it's not going to be any supernatural kind of thing, but who knows? I think it's going to be more my psyche will be affected by it. Pull the curtains open. You see a dimly lit room full of dusty furniture and trash. A doorway stands in the back, covered in dozens of scary little summonese wards, your shadow looming over it like an omen. A small, terrified, "Oh!" escapes from Plaisance as she tries her best to look away, her round face buried in her hands. Okay. Oh, interesting poster. Ghostly silhouettes of hair dryers. No sane person would ever put their head in such a machine. A vaguely androgynous portrait of a man. Oh. Thought it was a woman. Merely looking at that unmanly haircut threatens your masculinity. Oh, please. Okay, so I guess we're just going in here. Close the curtains again for her, but doesn't seem to be an option, so... Warded door. A heavy door with a missing handle stands before you, covered in dozens, if not hundreds, of Semonese trinkets and charms. It appears to be locked. Track down the knock on the door. Only an echo. No one is there. Unlock the door with the key. After exerting some force, you manage to turn the key. It's eerily silent. The door slides slightly open, letting a draft of cold air into the room. I'm gonna ask him to go first. Open the door and enter. Okay. One of these things a chimney? Sand is dripping from a punch bag. What's this? The ball! For Gaston! Just a minute, Kim. A ball used for playing shot put. You feel like you should hold on to this and make good use of it. To sell such beautiful old school sports equipment would be a sin. No, it'll be put to good use. Because we have this. You threw one of their pentank bulls far in the sea. Shot was excellent, but you owe them a boule or at least similar-looking metal sphere. Got it. Yes, Kim?
What is this place?
The lieutenant stares at the dusty training equipment. Looks like a gym to me. Yes, but no one's been here in ages. He draws a stripe on the dusty floor with his foot. I doubt the electricity still works. Good thing we have a flashlight on us. Don't forget to take it out of your bag before we move on. Inland Empire says an eerie feeling rises in your chest. Yeah, we're gonna have trouble with morale and stuff in here, aren't we? What if there's a reason why no one's been here for ages? Yes, because it's closed. No need to look for supernatural explanations where a banal one will do. Now let's move on, shall we? We want the flashlight out then, apparently. We still have our ape pen. Yeah, this can't be the one that... Kim gave us the other one, then. Tools. Flashlight. Okay. The poster says, Citius Fortis. The rest is worn off. I like how you move the mouse around in the light moves around. I don't know why I can't speak. worn out wall bars. They look unsafe. A barbell lies on the floor. The color has worn off its weight plates. Physical instrument says, it's 60 kilograms. Your triceps hum at the sight of these weights. Show the world what kind of beast it's dealing with. Lift them. Visual calculus says, there are no collars on the barbell. This is a safety hazard. And Land Empire says, why does it feel so familiar? Is this familiar because I'm a weightlifter? No, it's not that. It's the stale smell of rubber, the squeaky sound of sneakers, your bruised knee against the mat, and a whistle. Then the feeling is gone. Logic says it's just a memory. Endurance says, a memory from another life, when you were young and fit. Look, Kim, it's a trap. There are no collars on the barbell. You're right. The weights may fall off. Better not touch it, then. What kind of a jerk would just remove the collars? It should be a felony. It would be a violation of EPIS safety regulations if the gym was still operating, but it isn't. No one's supposed to come here anymore. Yeah, I'm not gonna mess with that. I don't see the point in doing so or risking anything. Are we just going in here? Can we go in there? Well, it's stairs, right? Oh, yeah. Hello. The hallway is blocked by old window panes and debris. I'm getting a little spooked here, but, I mean, this is not a supernatural game. I'm not sure what to expect, though. What's that noise? Is that music or a sound effect? What is that? A large demijohn full of strange liquid. What's a demijohn? Well, that's cool. Wild animals stare at you in the dark, stuffed and mounted. Oh boy. Oh! Does that look like a person hunched over? It actually does look like just a person hunched over. Oh, mannequins. That's not creepy at all. Airship rotors covered in spider webs. They remind you of blades. I guess we go through here, though. A naked mannequin torso. A strange yellow color. Okay, 3.12 real. Blue velvet, soft to the touch, moth-bitten. Is this Emma's atelier? Atelier? $1.55 real? Oh, I guess in both. Skis with slipstream printed on the laminated top layer. You know, that's the slipstream something with initials on that building next to the Whirling in Rags. That's the one with the slipstream CS or something like that. When we call there, there's a recording that acts as if, you know, we think we're speaking to it, but it's a recording. Steel rotor blades bearing a slipstream logo. Looks like someone tried to reconceptualize their business here. Conceptualization says. I don't get it. Look, the skis and rotor blades both bear the same slipstream logo. It seems likely that they started out making one, failed to turn a profit, and then pivoted to producing the other. But the question is, which did they start with, and which did they pivot to? That's a good question. It's just speculation. We don't know anything for sure. Not quite. You do know that there's something unusual about this company's business model. Yeah, there's something about it. Production, schedule, filament memory. We got it. The cube-like crisscross of filaments feels oddly fragile in your hand. Its intricate structure covered in dust. Silver tape on the side reads production schedule. Note, this filament contains information that can be read using a radio computer. Well, that's exactly what we're looking for Suna is her name, back in the church. So we got what we came here for, but we need to help with this curse, apparently. So, plus I want to finish looking around. It is pretty spooky, I'll give it that. The way the shadows move around, just that even. And all the noise. This place is resettling here. Mainframe. A dusty radio computer sleeps on its wired frame, forgotten and unused. Its keyboard has a rectangular on-off button. A piece of paper still hangs from the printer. Another radio computer, says the lieutenant, watching you circle around the machine. Just sitting here without anyone in sight. Interfacing says, this is the RAM Civic radio computer, model RC5120, equipped with a failed mainframe and a RAM-compatible printer. Do you think I should turn it on? It's your call, he looks over your shoulder, then back at the machine. You're in charge of this expedition, officer. Savoir Faire says, of course you should turn it on. Don't you want to know what's on the filament? Yeah, turning on the machine. The machine lights up like some prehistoric animal stirring from its slumber, revealing virescent play and print keys on the keyboard. The hatch on the machine's central compartment is wide open. Look inside the compartment. It's empty like a beehive without its brood. Some cables have been left tangling, disconnected. Surprise, it still works. The filament you have would fit perfectly inside the compartment. Just out of curiosity, I know it's going to work. Plus pray, nothing happens. Plus play again. Press print. Something's missing. There's no tape in the player. Duh. Nothing happens. Okay, insert the production schedule. Like a smooth drawer, the filament slides into place. On the keyboard, the play key starts blinking. Press play again. The speaker comes to life. Static seeps through the machine's planar magnetic driver. An old lady greets you. Her voice sounds 100 years old.
Good morning. Fortress accident en route de Saint-Guilain. This is East Insulandia, repeater station 1. Please repeat, is this the production schedule?
Yvonne, it's me again. How are you?
Good, thank you.
It's not clear whether she recognizes your voice.
Please repeat, is this the production schedule?
Let's try the password for the production schedule.
Good. Please repeat the password.
After life, death, I guess it is. Is it my birthday?
No.
Oh, we got... Yeah, encyclopedia working. A hint system is not part of the protocol for repeater stations. Say... Yeah, I don't want her to give up on me. And then it'd be inaccessible. So let's say, after life, death.
Good. I've unlocked the production schedule. After ending the call, please press print to access the filament.
Really? Kim says. She just used the same password? The lieutenant seems almost disappointed to discover that, as he murmurs. Maybe those radio computer guys aren't that paranoid after all.
Fortress accident, is there anything else I can do for you today?
That's all for now.
Thank you and goodbye.
The old lady's voice disappears along with the static. Tiles on the cube are still smoldering, casting the framework in a soft glow. Fluorescent play and print keys shine on the keyboard. Press print. With a quiet determination, the printer starts printing, a piece of paper unfolding like a handheld fan. A black crisscross of letters covers its surface. Alright, before we read it, we'll remove the production schedule. The filament slides out of its glowing nest. Let's read the printout. It's a project report written by the lead producer, Andrew Andy Schott, about Wural Untethered. Oh, that's one of the games in the bookshop down below. A radio game developed by Studio Fortress Accident. The first few pages give an overview of the capital and workforce, while the rest of it seems to be a production schedule. Makes sense. Capital, workforce, production schedule. Read about capital. I want to know about money. In its short time of existence, Fortress Accident SCA managed to burn through truly insane amounts of money. The first tranche of seed financing brought in 150,000 real, but then came the delays. Eventually, the damage reached 400,000 real with only half of the game finished. Gosh, where'd they get all this money? Let's just say it was a real adventure for their Agonian investor. Read about the workforce. Who worked there? How long? Fortress Accident employed 18 people, the bulk of the team composed of writers and concept artists. There were also radio programmers, sound engineers, a CEO, two marketing experts, and a partridge in a pear tree, and a single overburdened producer who developed a habit of popping pyroholodon in the basement to escape his obligations. Skim through the production schedule, whatever it is. The production schedule depicts the glorious descent into bankruptcy. Glorious? What happened? It was impossible not to fail. The project was too large, and no amount of money could satiate the ever-expanding ambitions of the development team. Were they working on Star Citizen? They tried to make a 4 million real game with 400,000 in their bank account. They thought they could bridge the gap with pure willpower and imagination. They couldn't. I couldn't have either. So they were done in by their own ambition. No. Even then, success remained within an ever-narrowing margin of possibility that, despite everything, never entirely disappeared. That is, until they discovered the Valley of the Heads. The what? At the seventh hour, the lead designer, Zimsk-born Sulisla Zawisa, I don't know, decided that Wural Untethered needed, that what Wural Untethered needed was a secret mystical location at the extreme edge of the map. The place was to be the Valley of the Heads, where the heads of all the headless constructs could be found. The player would have been able to choose a head for their headless party member, and each head would have been voiced on air by a professional actor. You know, I wonder if this is anything about the headless figure we bought recently in the, what do you call it? The pawn shop. This is some insane stuff. Who are these people? The world had never seen their kind before and might never again. How many heads were there? So many. At last count, there are approximately 10,000 heads for 10,000 headless men, all of which could be endlessly recombined. How many combinations could you make out of that? Do you really want to know? There seems to be a calculation here, but it might take a while. We don't really have a while. No, let's not go there. Good call. It's more than the number of atoms in the observable universe. I'm afraid the whole day would pass by. We need to solve this case. That's pretty bad, so that's what did them in? Well, yeah, that and the catastrophic data loss. This must be the anomaly Suna mentioned in the church log. On the nature of the data loss, there's ominously little information in the production log. It comes at the very end, where things get fuzzy and dark, where tables and numbers seem to vanish into an eerie nothingness before their Agonjan investor pull the plug. What is clear is that one day an unidentified numeric anomaly occurred on the East Revacholian Lintel front just as the Wural Untethered project was being computed that day. And the anomaly caused all the data to get lost in the air. When the project was returned, it was completely blank. The team spent weeks on the phone with Lintel, the service provider, but despite their diagnostics, they could never produce a satisfactory explanation or pay for the loss. What? They lost the whole game, Lintel, and wouldn't even pay for it? Always read the terms of service. Wasn't there a copy of the game? A backup? Mysteriously enough, it seems that the off-site copy happened to be on-site when the catastrophic data loss occurred. It was the lead programmer's responsibility to oversee weekly maintenance of the off-site copy and, well, keep it off-site. An explanatory note from the lead programmer has been attached. What does it say? S. Lucanin killed, the lead designer of Fortress Accident. The off-site copy was on-site because there was no off-site anymore. Not for me. Not after 8 months of crunch. I didn't have a home anymore, so I started keeping it in the basement, in the ice bear refrigerator, near where I went to sleep. It was perfectly safe there. The temperature conditions were optimal. It's not very convincing, is it? Her former colleagues would agree with you. Oh, okay, so it's a female programmer. Is there anything else from the lead programmer? The production schedule ends with a few random notes that seem to be added sometime later. Let's read them. 4 months later, by an unknown author, I am the only one left and it's gotten rather damp here. A few other businesses have gone under, too. Slipstream switched to making skis, and the hairdressers just left, cursing Martinez. They're right, though. Something's seriously wrong with this place. Martinez, all of it. So we're in that building. And I guess we can get down through the door. We're in that building with the door that we can't open with all the doorbells. Still haven't gotten an answer from Lintel about what happened. All I could get were the physical coordinates of the error on the East Insulandian front on that day. Since the computation happened on air, I reckon it had to coincide with an actually existing location. I have compared the coordinates to a map of Revachol West. Turns out it's only 800 meters from here. The address is St. Brune, 1147. I am going there to look this thing in the eye. St. Brune, 1147? That's what the street sign next to the church said. So were these notes from Suna then? St. Brune, 1147, yeah. Anything else? Nope, that's it. Tear off the printout and throw it away.